I'm Reverend Gretchen, and it's wonderful to welcome you, whether you're watching on TV or you find us on social media. Just know that our church is here for you. We care for our Weymouth and South Shore community. If you need someone to talk to, if you need help in the community, don't hesitate to contact us. We really do care. We have a saying in our denomination, no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. So welcome. Let me open with an epiphany call to worship. Epiphany is the season that we're in right after Christmas. And so let us be in the spirit of prayer. From the midst of our real lives with their very real problems, we come to seek courage and strength from the presence of God and the support of one another. As persons who love imperfectly and are loved imperfectly, we come to be renewed by the perfect love of God, proclaimed with love and faith. As persons who never fully live up to their high calling in Jesus Christ, we come for worship to be encouraged to do our best for one more week. Let us worship with hearts open to the love of God, with hands outstretched to one another, and with our whole selves willing to accept the cost and the joy of being Christ's disciples. And the people say, Amen. Welcome.
Thank you. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Maybe there's a God above, but all I've ever learned from love was how to shoot somebody who outdrew you. And it's not a cry that you hear at night, it's not somebody who's seen the light, it's a cold and it's a broken hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Hallelujah,
thank you. Good morning. Our scripture reading today is from the book of Isaiah. It's 43 verses 1 through 7. But now says the Lord, He who created you, O Jacob, He who formed you, O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, and you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I shall be with you, and through the waters, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt as your ransom, Ethiopia and Seba in exchange for you. Because you are precious in my sight and honored, and I love you, I give people in return for you, nations in exchange for life. Do not fear, for I am with you. I will bring your offspring from the east, and from the west I will gather you. I will say to the north, give them up, and to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from far away and my daughters from the end of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, who I created for my glory, who I formed and made. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God, and may he add his blessing to this scripture.
Hear these words from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 43, beginning with the first verse. When you go through deep waters and great trouble, I will be with you. When you go through rivers of difficulty, you will not drown. When you walk through the fire of oppression, you will not be burnt up. The flames will not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. All of us have faced times of uncertainty, turbulent times in our lives, and I guess we're all afraid of something or other. What are you afraid of? If you go to www.phobialist.com, you can find all sorts of phobias. I'm amazed at the number of things people are afraid of. Have you ever heard of these phobias? Dentophobia, fear of dentists. Automatonophobia, fear of ventriloquist dummies. Ecclesiophobia, one of my favorite, fear of the church. Need not be. Microphobia, fear of small things. Octophobia, fear of the number 8. Papaphobia, fear of the Pope. Photophobia, fear of light. Touchophobia, fear of speed. Zoophobia, fear of animals. Wouldn't you like to have a day now and then when you can go about your activities without fear of any kind? Be on any list of this, phobialist.com. To get real here, collectively as a society and indeed as a world, we live with very real and large fears. And they just seem to loom larger. Fear of violence, fear of disease, COVID, fear of fascism, fear of escalating crisis, fear of the climate crisis. We're in a new year, 2022, but a new year doesn't wipe away these fears. Consider this, though. God knew 3,000 years ago when God spoke through the prophet Isaiah, and 2,000 years ago when God spoke through Jesus, that we would always need the comfort that comes to us when we are facing fear, the comfort that comes to us by trusting and leaning on God. When we find ourselves afraid, when we're going through turbulent times and adversity, we need to hear these words of God. When you go through deep waters and great trouble, I will be with you. Jesus also has encouraging words in the New Testament, in the Gospel of John, chapter 16. I have told you all this so that you may have peace in me. Here on earth you may have many trials and sorrows, but take heart, because I have overcome the world. Jesus wants us to trust in him, and in this season of Epiphany, when we celebrate Emmanuel, God within us, the Christ child who lives with us and for us and guides us and carries us. In this time of Epiphany, God, Jesus, wants to give us power to feel like we can overcome times of uncertainty and adversity with faith. The ancient Israelites knew fear. In fact, the first 39 chapters of Isaiah are filled with nothing but peril, distress, sin, judgment, and fear. The nation's been conquered by the great power to the east, Babylon. And the children of Israel, the sons and daughters of Abraham's promise, the ones chosen by God for a special mission in the world, had been captured and forced marched into captivity far away from their home. Many had lost loved ones in a savage conquest. Most didn't know if they'd ever see their homeland again, and all surely felt abandoned and cut off from God. They were adrift, prisoners in a foreign land. There's an article with the author Paul Brockman who describes the exiles in this manner. It's from the Journal of Bible and Theology. He says, "Rarely has history seen more concentrated misery than was to be found among these captives. Mothers had been separated from their children and husbands from their wives. When they sat down to think of the past, they must have often shuddered at the memory of the terrible siege, of the loved ones dead on the field of battle, of the children who perished miserably on the march to Babylon, and of the homes forever destroyed." This was not an abstract exercise for the Israelites. These were people who were chosen by God, led through the wilderness, and established as a great nation. And now they were conquered, beaten, and exiled. Did that mean that the Babylonian gods were stronger than the Israelite God? They had to know. So the first 39 chapters of Isaiah are foreboding. But at chapter 40, things change. The prophecy begins to address the exiles with words of hope, with words of encouragement, with words of God. What a difficult job that was at that time in history. Well, this same article goes on to say, to address exiles about God is to call out over the graveyard where hope is buried. To address exiles about God is to call out over the graveyard where hope is buried. But to that graveyard of hope, Isaiah speaks in chapter 40 when he says, "Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak softly and tenderly to your Jerusalem. She has served her sentence. Her sin is taken care of and forgiven." And then in chapter 43, he says, "Don't be afraid. I've redeemed you. I've called your names. You are mine." Isaiah was telling the people that their relationship with God had survived the toughest of times. And there was no reason to be afraid any longer, because God had recovered the people that were once lost. With God, hope is never buried. We're not in it alone, folks, if we find times when we are fearing or fear, or times when we feel like we are overcome by turbulence. Some of the greatest words that were spoken, I think, spoken by President Franklin D. Roosevelt. This is not political, this is just great words of all time. At his first inaugural address, he said, "I am certain that my fellow Americans expect that on my induction into the presidency, I will address them with a candor and a decision which the present situation of our people impel. This is preeminently the time to speak the truth, the whole truth, frankly and boldly. Nor need we shrink from honesty facing conditions in our country today. This great nation will endure as it has endured, will revive and will prosper. So first of all, let me assert my firm belief that the only thing we have to fear is fear itself. Nameless, unreasoning, unjustified terror, which paralyzes needed efforts to convert retreat into advance. The greatest threat we face from our fear is becoming paralyzed in the face of it. And what God is showing us here through prophecy and through the Christ child, there is nothing that can happen to us that can ultimately keep us from God. If we let it, fear will take away our faith and strip our courage and rob us of our confidence. And fear will keep us tied to our seats when the situation demands action. But God is asking us to step up in faith, to rise up, and to follow Christ. He says, when you're in over your head, I'll be there with you. This is the God who comes to us as Emmanuel. God is with us right here and right now and says, through the prophet Isaiah, so don't be afraid. We belong to God. We know that because that is what is recorded in Isaiah's prophecy, God has created us, personally formed and made each one of us. There's nothing in the world that can separate us from God's love. But we are never completely lost because we are never alone. And we are never lost because we have learned that there is really nothing to fear when Christ is with us. I close with a simple quote by Louisa May Alcott. She says, I'm not afraid of storms, for I'm learning how to sail my ship. So in this new year ahead, no matter what storms there are, may we remember that God is with us. We do not walk alone. We have the Christ child guiding our way. And may we learn through the storms how to sail our ships, so to speak, with the love of Christ. Do not be afraid.
Thank you.
hope for the week to come, for the days to come. Know that you are so fully loved by God and by Jesus, Emmanuel, with us. Here I send with you off with a word of benediction, sending forth. May you go into the world. You are the body of Christ. God grant you the eyes of Christ to perceive human need, Christ's hands to heal, and Christ's heart to love through the dynamic energy of the Holy Spirit. And may you go forward with the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. Amen.